Welcome to another edition of Beginner Breakdown. I am your host, Matt Kummer. Today we have a game submitted by an audience member. So without further ado, let's check it out. Maya is playing White against Rob. All right. So here we go, both unrated players. Here we go. So White starts out the conventional way, E4, very good. And Black coincides with the popular E5. White brings out the knight to attack the pawn. So Black defends it with D6. All right, so now White sees a check in this position. So she decides to play it. Unfortunately, it's not the best move because Black can simply block the check with C6, forcing the bishop off of B5 to a better square, C4. So let's just take a quick look at this sequence again. So bishop check, Black plays C6, Ray retreats to C4, and it's Black to move. Okay, so let's take a look as if we would have just brought our bishop to C4 first, okay? And then Black decides, hey, I want to bring my pawn to C6 here. And now it's White to move, okay? So you thought by checking you were doing a good thing, but you were just letting Black get essentially a free move, okay? So you want to watch out for that check, okay? All right, so bishop check, pawn blocks, bishop back to C4, aiming at the ever-popular F7 square, the weakest square in chess because it's only defended by the king, and kings cannot capture protected pieces. Okay, so I know everybody at home knows what Black's going to do, attack the bishop again. But he didn't. All right, he fooled me. All right, knight F6. He attacks the pawn instead, so that's good. So now White needs to find a way to protect this pawn here. Knight to C3. So I don't think this is going to cut it because Black should be able to get in B5. So I retreat the bishop, and now we have a tactic. Remove the defender. So this knight is the defender, right, of this pawn. So what should Black play to win a pawn here? Any guesses? So this knight is defending this pawn, right? Because if this knight wasn't here, knight would come and take the pawn, right? Okay, so now we must dislodge this knight from C3.
So, move the pawn up?
Yeah, we just move the pawn up, and then it's like, oh man, I got to move my knight because I don't want to lose my knight. And then knight takes the pawn. Okay, so we got to be really careful how we protect our pawn. So in that situation, should have just played pawn to d3, protected the pawn, and it also would have activated this bishop here. Okay? All right, so b5, bishop back. And unfortunately, Black plays bishop e7 instead of winning the pawn. So now White solidifies the position d3. Black castles, White castles. So far so good. Black has failed to do any tactics to win some pawns here. But other than that, so far so good. Okay, so now knight comes down and attacks h2 and f2 here. All right, so. But unfortunately, a knight can't do it all by itself because this pawn is protected two different ways by the knight and the king. This pawn also protected by the rook and the king. So it's not really doing much. So if I was playing White here, I would just be like, go away. Okay?
So it's a wasted move though by black.
Right, right. Yeah. H3. And now I've made a little escape square for my king, so I don't want to get back row checkmated. And now this knight just has to go backwards. And it's like, all right, and now it's my move. So I just got essentially a free move. All right, so instead, play bishop to e3. So you put your bishop where it can get taken. So if you put pieces in squares where they're in danger and to get captured, you have to say, oh, him, or hey, man, he might actually trade that, right? So never be shocked, like, if you put a piece where it can get captured and it's like, oh, I just got my piece captured, right? So did you want to trade this knight for the bishop here in this position, or was it like, oh, it's all good either way?
Yeah, I guess.
Okay, fair enough. All right, so knight takes bishop, but now you have the dreaded double pawns. You know what a double pawn is? Double pawns are pawns that are on the same file. All right, you see how a file is the vertical line. So, you know, they can't really protect each other. They're always getting in each other's ways because they're on the same squares, you know, on the same file. So they're not as good as connected pawns, which they can protect each other and have a lot of fun, okay? All right. So bishop to g4, implementing a pin. So this knight is in a pin, meaning if it moves, bye-bye queen, okay? So let's see how you handle that. Once again, I would just play h3 and force the issue, like, you want to trade or what? All right, instead you play d4, which is a good move. You're like, let's get rid of these double pawns. And so your opponent obliges. That was very nice of your opponent to do that. All right, because he did not have to take that pawn. Okay, it's not checkers. Just because you see a capture doesn't mean you have to capture, okay? All right, so now bishop attacks the pawn. All right, but you have two defenders. But one defender is pinned. So let's see what happens. Okay, so you play a3. Okay. So it kind of makes room for the bishop just in case, just for later. All right, so rook to e8. So this is good for black. He's putting his rook on an active file here and threatening this pawn. All right. So now when you play a4, once again, he's got a good move to remove the defender of the knight. What are the chances he's gonna see it this time around? No. All right, so instead, it plays the dubious. Bishop takes d4 check. He's hoping that you play knight takes bishop, right? But she's smarter than that. She's like, no, I'm not gonna take it that way. I'll take with the queen. Good. All right. And now bishop takes the knight, but now the rook can just take. And things are looking really good for white. You just got a bishop worth 3 points for just a measly pawn that's worth 1 point. So you definitely made out well on that that round. All right. So play c5 here. So let's just think for a second. I understand our queen is under attack, okay? But what are some good attacks that white is trying to generate in this attack? Which square is white really focused on right now? Some of his forces. Like, let's say this rook, and let's say this bishop. What square are they both converging on in this position? Do you see what this rook is aiming at and this bishop is aiming at? Okay, the pawn on f7, okay? So we could just play right off the bat, bishop takes f7 check, which I would not recommend. even though it might be the best move, but it's not the best move. Okay, so now, but our queen is under attack here, right? So let's move our queen, but let's have her help this attack. So what move would we make with the queen to attack f7? Where could that queen go to help attack f7?
Move up one,
yeah, to d5. And then look at what that does, too. It also attacks the rook. The rook, eventually. Okay. So that's what you want to do. But okay, so we go back one, and uh-oh, that's not where we want to be. Look, our queen and bishop are on the same rank, one file apart, okay? And he's got this measly pawn sitting here. What do you think that pawn wants to do? Here he comes, the fork, the pawn fork, okay? You don't want to be pawn forked because it's so easy to avoid, right? I mean, you have to do it to yourself, really. You have to put your pieces all on the same line, just one file apart. And he's got the guy there, so not cool. But it's okay, because he misses it. And so he brings out the knight, all right? So now, in this position, what move do you think you should do? And I'll give you a hint. You have a check in this position. Do you see your one and only check? So which piece could possibly make a move that attacks the opponent's king in this position? We're looking for a check. Bishop takes f7, check, yes. And that would be good because the king would have to move, and then we'll get the rook, all right? So we're looking pretty good. All right, but instead, we take the pawn, attacks the knight, very good. So the knight now has a good place to go, unfortunately, and it's another fork. So a fork, if you hear the term fork in chess, it's just a fancy word for double attack. So where can this knight hop to that protects f7 on top of it and attacks two of your major pieces?
E5,
good. But unfortunately, he missed it. Bummer. Okay, so he goes to b4, that also attacks. All right, so knight to b4 attacks the queen. So now queen just goes all the way back to d1. All right. So now after rook to b8, it finally comes together. It finally dawns on her. She can take. Yes. And then king h8, we take. Queen takes. And life is good for white. All right, yeah, and just keep taking stuff. Rook takes a7, all free. Rook takes b5. Not recommended because that pawn was protected. So we don't want to capture pawns and pieces that are, defended. All right, so knight captures b5. So knight to c6. So we actually have a really cool move in this position. A natural move in this position would be, hey, our rook's under attack. Let's take it, okay? But let's see if we can find out what happens if we just take this pawn here. And then Rob's like, oh, free rook. All right. So do we have a monster check in this position? We do. We have two of them. They're both monster, okay? So any check you have, if you find a check, you got the right answer, okay? whether you play queen check, rook check, they're both going to lead to check mate. Okay? But moving the rook, pretty good, right? You can't go wrong, you didn't lose a rook. So now, queen to b8. So this queen needs to stay on this back row, or else you're gonna get back row checkmated. So, look at this, free knight, okay? And now rook takes b5. Queen takes b5, excuse me, queen takes b5. So, what should white instantly do in this position? Rook to c8? You even have better than that, but that's pretty good too. Rook to c8. That way you get the king and the queen. I like it. All right. Boom. Okay. So that works out pretty well. In this position, rook f8, instant mate, okay? That way, if you play like a person that's unsportsmanlike and you play this move, all right, he might just sit there for 15 minutes and just, I don't know what I should do, you know? So don't even give him the option, the satisfaction of just sitting there. So you just say, game over, next, like, let's go, yep, so. So okay, so queen takes b5. So now you prepare rook to f8 with queen f1, but there was no need to prepare it because look, we had checkmate, right? All right, and he tries his best to get out of checkmate, which he should just play queen takes queen check. King takes, and then what move would he play to get out of to avoid checkmate here?
Move the pawn.
Yeah. H6 preferably, okay? Because if you play G6 here, you're gonna have mate in about two here. Let's say we play rook here, all right? King moves. How do we checkmate black in three moves, let's say? Maybe just two if you're really good. But you better be careful because your rook's attacked. So I'll give you a hint. You want to move this rook. Where should you put him? And there's about three right answers. Well, look at that. Three right answers. And it can only go to like 14 squares maybe. Maybe not even that many. D7, that's one of the three. That's one of the three, yeah. And then he goes here.
Rook to
c8, checkmate. Yep, game over. So good. Yeah, so you wanted to keep this rook on the seventh rank, preferably far away from the king. D7 was far enough. B7 or A7 were the other two answers. And then you're genius. But in the actual game, this is how the game concluded. Black thought king there might stop the mate, but unfortunately, it did not. Checkmate. So that was the official end of Maya versus Rob. So do you want to see your other two games that you wrote down? All right, so it's round two for Maya versus Rob. Once again, Maya gets the white pieces, so that's pretty nice. All right, so white starts out with the move. E4. Black counters, knight f6. This is called the Alekhine's defense, okay? It has some advantages and it has some drawbacks. The big drawback is you're going to have to move like your knight on your first five moves. But white is going to make moves that might potentially weaken his position, so we'll see.
You don't want to move your knight that early?
Well, the pawn can move up and play e5, knight here, then we can play c4, knight there, okay? And then maybe this pawn will come up, a4, try to chase him around again. Black will play d6, a5. So
you're just being chased around.
yeah, you're just being chased around endlessly. But look at White's moves, though. I mean, they're not really moves that you would really brag about. Like, look, I got my pawn on A5. Look at me. All right? So I mean, if you can handle it, knight F6 is not the worst move ever. Okay. So White just decides, hey, I'm just going to protect it. All right, so Black plays E5. So now we got more of a standard position. And unfortunately, White, you play D3 in this position, okay? So when you play this move, who had, like, you know, 5 moves, and now he's been reduced to just 1? So in this position, one of your players has 5 moves, now just 1. So you know who you just severely limited with that move? The bishop. Yeah, why did you do that to their bishop? They wanted to have fun and attack F7, right? But instead, now he's a prisoner thanks to D3, okay? So that's just something to think about, okay? All right, so don't worry, because Rob's going to do it too. D6. So now he decided he'll trap his bishop too, all right? So now knight to D5. So in the opening, you really want to get your pieces developed, like that bishop to C4 or even E2. Then bring the knight to F3 and get castled, right? Like, your knight was doing fine on C3 here, okay? And now after he goes here, okay, that really doesn't help you develop at all. All it gave you was, what are these things called now? 2 pawns on the same line. Remember that? Double pawns, all right? Double pawns, not the best, okay? All right, I'm not sure, but I believe Black played the move C6 in this position. All right, and White counters with the move D4. And now, queen to A5 check, attacking the pawn. So they went after bishop D2. Black picks off the pawn. Very good. All right, White decides to protect his d pawn with bishop to e3. And Black just gets his bishop off the back row, bishop to e7. Now, you could maybe attack the queen here with c4, but White decides bishop to e2. Black calmly castles. And now, it looks like you bring your bishop back to d3 now, aiming at the h7. So you really moved around the bishop a lot here. And I mean a lot. So, is there any move for Black here now that this bishop isn't on his original square f1? What's this queen aiming at here?
G2.
Yeah. And that's where he needs to be. But instead, he decides to zoom over and give him a check. Okay? It's better to take things. Because check, I mean, it's kind of cool, check. But it really doesn't gain anything. You want to play checks when you're doing that forking, when you're doing double attacks and stuff. When you're actually going to gain something, all this does is, you know, he's just going to chase your queen around. All right, so bishop to d2. Uh-oh. And so the queen is under attack. Oh, my. All right, so queen to b4. So the queen had to really get out of that line here. All right, as in just back to c7 or b6 even. But when he plays queen to b4, it's true he's attacking the pawn, but he's still in the line as the bishop, and game over. All right, bishop takes b4. Now c5, pawn takes c5, pawn takes c5, bishop to c3. But it's good as black to not give up, to keep trying, keep forcing, and seeing what he can do here. So knight to c6, queen to d2, bishop out, white castles long, okay? So he's got some ideas here. Should white capture this pawn on a2 here? What do you think? I mean, it looks like a free pawn, right? It's a little trickier than it usually is, though. Because usually a great way to trap it is like this. Okay? Does that make sense? Okay, because then I'm going to bring my king over and I'm going to take you. But look at this nifty move black has in this position. C4. So, okay, my bishop's under attack. I might as well just take it, you know. And then what happens to... it doesn't even work after all that. Black checks, and it's not checkmate. Because this bishop slides in and... life is good, and I'm going to get you. Okay, so the answer is black should not take the pawn on a2.
Is it normally better to castle on the long side or the short side, or is there
In this position, since white is up a queen in this position, the question is should a white castle long, short, or does it even matter? You see how black has a lot of players, you know, potentially coming to this queen side. So I would think in this position he would have been a lot safer if he was over on g1. But it's all good. Without a queen, it's going to be really tough for black to generate an attack. But you saw in that possibility, in that instance, you know, unless he had this bishop, he might have been checkmated, so. But it probably shouldn't matter either which way. Oh, wait, so they do not take the pawn. Instead, rook to d8. Which rook do you think went there? The f rook or this rook? Any guesses?
I would guess that one you got there.
Okay, rook to d8. That's a good place for it, okay? It's pinning the bishop. So this is a real live attack now. And good. White notices, hey, I'm in a pin here. I don't like to be in a pin because black is threatening to attack my pin piece. That's what we do to pin pieces. We attack them with c4, e4, and then bye-bye bishop. So queen e2, very good. Wait, you don't want the rooks and the queens in the same file, so get out of there. And so now black's like, okay, I'm going to take this pawn here. Bishop takes a2. So obviously, we all know now we need to play b3, and we don't have to worry about getting checkmated. All right. But instead, you decide, hey, I'll get my knight out here and see what's happening. Rook to c8. You play bishop to f5. Bishop f5 attacks the rook. Makes sense. And now rook to b8. I got to get out of there. Now bishop to d2. Knight d4 attacks the queen and the bishop. Queen takes e5. Bishop to d6. All right, so this is a very, very, very interesting position here. Okay, bishop to d6. All right. So the queen can capture four things. The pawn, but let's not worry about the pawns. You can either take the bishop or the knight in this position. If you could go back in time, Maya, which one would you take, the bishop or the knight?
Probably.
Well, it's 100% correct, yes. We want to take the pieces that are not protected. Okay, like, oh, you can't get me. Oh, you can get me, okay? So you don't want to capture protected pieces, okay? If, you know, your piece is worth more than the one you're taking, okay? Because you're essentially traded $9 for just three. Bad trade, right? Okay. So all right, you live and learn, right? All right, so, but you're unfazed. You're like, okay, you got my queen back, but I'm going on the attack. I'm gonna threaten the H guy here. All right, so it looks like play king to the corner here. And then rook e1. Well, I guess the whole idea of king h8 is we don't want to get bishop takes pawn checked. So rook e1, rook e8. So then we decide to flee the file with rook to f1. We want to try to control this file. Rook takes, knight check doesn't work because this bishop is coming down to capture that. But we definitely don't want to cede the control of this file here. All right, so rook f1. So now bishop e6. Bishop takes e6. Pawn takes e6. c3. Pawn takes c3. All right. So we definitely want to get our bishop on this diagonal toward the king, okay? We want to get our pieces on the same line as pieces that are worth more. King, obviously, is worth the most because if you get the king, you win the game, right? So it's really cool to have pieces on the same diagonal as the king. And now this pawn would be in an absolute pin. It cannot move. Okay? So that might be an idea. Okay, so pawn takes c3. Rook to c8, putting the pawn in a pin. Great idea. Rook back to e1. e5. All right, it's marching on. King to c2. We might want to play king to b2 just to get it out of the same line as the rook, you know? Make sense? All right, king to c2, h6, telling the knight, get out of here. So he does. He obliges. So now, which piece is under attack?
The bishop,
right. So we better move the bishop. And he makes a decent move, you know. The pawn is in a pin, so he's under no risk of getting captured by this pawn because the rook would come down and capture the king. So good. Bishop there. So now plays king to b1. More aggressive would be king to b3. As you see, this is now an end game. We've transitioned from middle game to early end game. In the end game, you really want your king to be active, okay? A fighting piece. He's no longer just a sheltered in his castle, okay? He can be an attacker, okay? He just has to watch out for checks and all that other good stuff, but he can be an attacker. He would be safe on b3. Okay, but king to b1. And, uh-oh. So rook to c4. And, well, It just doesn't compute, okay? Because our bishop is now under attack because this pawn is no longer in a pin. Unfortunately, he doesn't see that after pawn takes and rook takes knight, a rook is worth 5, he's a major piece. Knight is worth 3, a minor piece. Not a good trade. So rook takes, and now white should have a pretty simple win, but you never know, right? You never know. Rook to e1. You think you bring this rook out to e1? Good, good. Yeah, double the rooks, all right? Excellent. So a5, pawn takes a5, pawn takes a5. So now black has a passed pawn. And he's doing okay. White is, obviously. Okay, so in this position, you got him pretty good. So this is a pretty neat idea for white, I guess. In this position, I would be thinking about checkmate. But we got a situation here, right? Rook's on f2, bishop's attacked, pawn's attacked. Who do you want to save, the bishop or the pawn?
Bishop.
Good, the bishop. Okay. So where is a? So.
Would you ignore the bishop now?
No, I would never ignore the bishop. The bishop actually has some cool moves here. One being bishop here, pinning the pawn. Or I might even think about sacking it and putting my rook there. But, I mean, there's no reason to even do that because I don't see a forced checkmate from here. But it's looking pretty good for white. But unfortunately, white decides to protect the g pawn, okay? And that leaves the bishop. And look, very important in the endgame to have active pieces. Not very active right now. So we gotta figure that out.
So don't trap your best pieces.
Right, so now all he's doing is pretty much babysitting this pawn. And look, this king, even if you play c1, if you just keep your rook on the second rank here, I mean, it's going to be really tough for white to make progress the way his pieces are kind of tangled up right now. Okay? But he'll get there. All right, so after king to c1, he decides to stop the pressure and move back to d8. And now that rook finally gets to an open file. And now he's all happy again, and he's feeling pretty good. So check, does nothing, king to d1. We want our king up here so we can checkmate. So we don't want him down here. So we'll just check back and forth a little bit. And now he's like, see, if black just kept checking, right? I mean, this game could go on for days, right? So white is you have to bring your king up here, all right? When he's checking you, okay? That way, it'll stop the chain of checks. But don't go there, or else you just lost your rook. But did you just lose your rook? No, it's a trick, checkmate, essentially. All right, but just march your king up there, and that way it will stop the chain, okay? All right, but black's gonna be nice, and he's gonna stop the chain for you with g6. All right, so in this position, what move should white make? let's because ideally this king would want to fly out of here, okay? So what move would we make as white here? What move would stop black from coming king to g7?
Bishop to
f7. All right, rook f7, good. All right, so king here, and then same thing, we wouldn't want to keep our rook over here. All right, and now black's looking pretty bad here, okay? And then we can just attack this pawn, nothing he can do. Rook takes, and we'll threaten checkmate. He'll go here, and we're great, you know? Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so remember, in the end game, we really want active pieces, like these pieces, very, very active. They're doing something. If my king's active and yours is just sitting home with his feet up, just waiting to get checkmated, you know? Because he's not doing anything. So think about that. All right. Well, thank you for coming to another edition of Beginner Breakdown. All right.